The following podcast is a presentation of This Is Infamous. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome. It's episode 36 of the CineFiles podcast. It's been a while. We've taken kind of a long break. We've had a lot of things going on in our lives and just schedules didn't mesh or anything like that. Even today, Andre won't be able to join us because he's busy doing something. It's a Saturday. It's a very hot, sunny Saturday, I should add, here in New York City. So it's just going to be Jeff and I. Jeff Galishaw, say hello.
Nanu, nanu.
And I'm Eric Cohen. And this is a CineFiles podcast. So, since it's been a while, we decided to keep things simple and just focus on the stuff we've recently seen or a lot of much-anticipated films that came out recently. I'm sure that our listeners would like to get our thoughts on that. Maybe one or two news items we'll touch upon that have come out recently and are topical. And, so starting off, Jeff, what have you been up to? Movie relation wise, see anything good lately?
Oh, I've seen plenty since we've last talked. Some good, some bad, some noteworthy, some eh. I've been trying to get back into, you know, the foreign films and the classic films.
Right.
But unfortunately, I've seen probably more modern day stuff than anything. So, you can always check out my current film reviews on CineFilesTV.blogspot.com. So I'll try to not talk about films I've already reviewed there.
Okay.
I saw actually a film that came out a few years ago. It might be pretty lightweight to people, but I really thought it was good. It's a film called Rudderless with a Billy Crudup, Anton Yelchin, Lawrence Fishburne, and Selena Gomez.
I haven't heard of this.
I just discovered it on Netflix. I still have the disc service, so I thought, I think I saw a preview of it when I was watching another DVD, and it looked interesting.
Okay.
And it pretty much is paint by numbers for the most part, but this film actually has, like, a twist in the middle of it that's like a gut punch that makes everything after it and makes you rethink everything that came before it. And I think I'm not going to say it's like the greatest, but I think it's something noteworthy, and William H. Macy directed it and has a small role in it.
Interesting.
So that one was, it made me finally, I guess, I mean, I've always seen Billy Crudup as a capable actor, but this was the first time where I really like dug one of his performances. And
okay, so you like the film?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right.
But, like, it's nothing to write home about, but, you know, I really enjoyed it.
Mm. Oh, good. Mm. Yeah, I mean, I've seen a lot of stuff since we last podcast. I don't want to go into every single thing I've seen, but there were things I saw, there's something that you recommended that I finally saw, and I forgot what that was.
No, of course. How convenient.
And I think I liked it. If I can remember what it was, I would tell you.
Was it a theatrical? Was it?
Honestly, I'm completely drawing a blank on it, but maybe we'll get back to it.
Okay.
But you know, I guess what we should do is like we should focus on the big titles, the Batman versus Supermans and the Civil War.
Okay.
But before we do that, I did see something I had been looking forward to seeing for a while. I saw High Rise.
Okay, as did I.
Right, the Ben Wheatley adaptation of the J.G. Ballard novel.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big fan of the novel. And I have to say I was very impressed with the movie. I enjoyed it a great deal. Not entirely faithful, but I was okay with that.
Okay. I enjoyed it to a degree. I read the book a number of years ago, so I didn't remember 100% of it, but I remembered the gist of it. And the movie I enjoyed because I just liked the style of the direction and how at one point the lunacy just goes over the top and refuses to really make sense unless I think you really followed British politics.
or social, it's more social issues than political issues.
Okay.
You know, because they have a, you know, there's a sort of undefined social class structure in Britain. And it kind of, like, tweaks that a bit. And there's other stuff going on. That's not the only ideas that are being played around there.
Okay, but I did like that it was mostly designed as, like, a 1970s.
Yeah, I love that aesthetic. It was really cool. It kind of takes place in a near future, but it looks, as a near future, it kind of looks like the 70s. I like that aspect of it a lot. I thought visually it was fantastic. I would say that the caveat I would have with this film is it's not going to be for everybody because Wheatley approaches structuring it in a certain way where I could see where people be confused.
Yes.
you know, and that might be where, like, having read the novel helped a little bit.
You know, probably.
Like, you get, like, little visual, like, montage representations of, say, Tom Hiddleston's character. You barely get it in the film, but in the book it's more pronounced that he never wants to leave the building. Once he's there, he doesn't need anything outside of it. And so he finds himself more and more withdrawn and more, you know, keeping within that building. But you only get a sense of that through some of the strange, surreal, you know, montages and stuff like that. You know, like,
sure.
Like he wants to leave the building, but he turns around and he's going against the crowds, that kind of thing. I would say the biggest difference between this and the novel is that in the movie, his sister's dead.
Oh, yes.
Whereas the novel, he's recently divorced and his sister's still alive, and she's a main character. She lives in his apartment with him. But I'm not spoiling anything when I say that.
No, I know.
That's incidental to what actually happens. But it was great cast.
Yeah, it's first time I remember seeing Sienna Miller, I believe, since American Sniper in anything.
Mm. Yeah, she's really good in it. Although her character, they kind of like combine characters for her character in the movie. In the book, it's like a bunch of characters. I thought Elizabeth Moss was really good in it.
Yeah, I just thought, I guess, that there would be more Elizabeth Moss in the film, in the end product. Because, you know, I mean, she's good in it, but it just seemed like, you know, half the time she's barely there, but that might actually work with her character because she's one of the few you really care about.
Well, the only, next to Jeremy Irons, the only other quote-unquote prominent character was Luke Evans' character.
Yes, and I was...
And
I was
he was fantastic in this.
Yes, because I haven't seen him since The Immortal. I think I'm the only one person who enjoyed that movie.
Oh, I haven't seen him since It Begins. Dracula.
Oh, yes. I still have not seen that movie.
But
Dracula. And unfortunately, Charles Dance was not in this movie with him.
It now begins. instead you had gratuitous Jeremy Irons. Jeremy Irons was very good at it. I did not recognize what's-his-name until, like, maybe, like, the last 15 minutes of the film. Another British actor. He was, what was he in that they tried to make high-profile? And it flopped. He was in John Carter, Warlord of Mars, whatever.
You see, I wouldn't even remember which character he played.
I'm drawing a blank on his name. I'll have to look it up. But, yeah, no, I liked High Rise a lot. I like High Rise a lot.
I enjoyed it. I don't think I enjoyed it as much as you, mm-hmm. but you're also the bigger Ben Wheatley fan than I am.
Well, this is the thing. This is why I'm a fan of Ben Wheatley. Not one film is the same.
That's true.
This, again, is an entirely different film than Field in England, which is an entirely different film than Kill List, which is an entirely different film than Sightseers. I'm really impressed with how, how versatile he is. James Purefoy.
The name sounds familiar, but the face.
James Purefoy. Yeah, I didn't recognize him at all until like maybe the last 15 minutes of the film.
Okay. I'll have to look at his picture later.
Yeah, I mean, you'll recognize him when you see him. He was in, what was that film called? Sort of a 1600 based on a popular Hulk character thing.
It wasn't like Black Death or anything like
that. No, it's kind of Black Death-like.
Oh, I think I know the film you're talking about, but the name isn't coming to me.
Yeah, he was in... I'm looking it up, guys. Sorry. Looking it up. And I should know this because I'm familiar with the books. Solomon Kane.
Yes, I saw that film.
He was Solomon Kane.
Okay, I remember that movie.
Okay. I apologize for that. But anyway, so yeah, I like the film. I also caught up with The Witch.
Yes, so did I.
Really liked it a lot.
I enjoyed it more than I expected to, because even though it's not predictable, but you kind of, at a point, see where it might be going, but it still manages to surprise you.
I just think it has some of the best child acting I've ever seen in a film.
I can see that. I really liked it more for the atmosphere that it provides.
Yeah, no, I it was one of those films, like it, you know, you get these films that get a lot of buzz, you know, through the festival circuit, and then you wind up watching that, and you're like, oh, it's good, I just, you know, not as good as everyone says it is.
Yeah.
This wasn't one of those films. It was about as good as everyone said it was, I thought.
Oh, God.
We had a little brief discussion on this, where we can get in depth about The Invitation.
Okay. The Invitation. I'm sorry. I really enjoyed that film. I can see your arguments. The one that made me laugh about your putting the film down. Everybody was too good looking.
Well, let's put context on this. Jeff and I had a brief discussion about this before via Facebook. It's hard to be nuanced and contextual via text, right?
True.
The Invitation, if you haven't heard of it, it's another one of these films, thrillers, horror film, whatever you want to call it, that's gotten a lot of positive buzz. A lot of critics saying, oh, you got to see this one. This is a sleeper. And I saw it, and I was like, I thought it was okay. I didn't think it was great. you know, it's an interesting premise. You know, there's a dinner mm-hmm. party being held by the ex-wife of this one principal character. It's you get this idea that he's not entirely over that breakup. He's had a rough time of it, and he's uncomfortable entering into this situation because she's throwing this party with her new boyfriend or new husband, whoever. And he starts to suspect that something sinister is going on there. Like, they started to lock all the doors in the house so that nobody can get out. Stuff like that. And they may be trying to sell them something. Now, I'm not going to give anything away. It is a very good idea. And it is well shot mm-hmm. and, for the most part, well directed. I just felt that the script was just a sketch. I felt that the characters were just stock type characters. I didn't feel any empathy towards them. The point that Jeff was laughing about was that they seemed a little too perfect looking to me. They didn't seem like real, like nothing about them, these characters, seemed grounded in a real enough way where I was empathetic to the situation or I cared what happened to them. And I felt and the other problem was the dialogue. I thought the dialogue was just kind of twee. And that kind of like that kind of stifled my enjoyment of the film. I think the lead was very good in it.
Okay, local.
But even he had sort of this like kind of hipster kind of look about. Everything just seemed a little too affected.
Okay.
That makes sense. And we're not going to spoil anything. It has a really interesting finale.
I guess maybe I didn't go in with such high, hopes. I knew it had been, a lot of people had praised it. But, I just went in like, okay, this can either be really slow or this could be interesting. And I just found it interesting more than anything. I understood one of your kind of criticisms where it seemed like also the film went out of its way to have a diverse cast. Like, everybody had to be represented in that, friendship group. You have the gay couple, you have the Asian, you have his new girlfriend, who's African-American.
Which is not a problem.
Yeah, it's not a problem.
But the thing was, and this is the thing I also tried to explain contextually to Jeff, just before literally that night when I saw the film, just before that I went to a brunch party. And the makeup of this party was almost identical to the makeup that's represented in the film. You had a gay couple, just like you did in the film. You had, mixed race couple, just like you had in the film. All that stuff. But these are real people. They were genuinely funny and humorous. And you felt like they were friends for a while and all that stuff. Whereas in this film, it just felt like people were placeholders. And they're too affected, and I didn't get the sense that they really had a history together. They were friends once, or you know what I mean? It just seems like there was no before everything that happens. There's no life beyond that.
Yeah, like they were just pieces of the puzzle for the story.
Right, that's how I felt. Having said that, it is an interesting premise, and it does hold your attention.
Yes.
You do want to see where, you want to stick with it to see where it's going, definitely.
Well, what I enjoyed also was that, just like the character, at certain points you think you have something figured out, and then it turns the tables and, debunks it to a degree.
Mm-hmm.
And then, it seems like, okay, yeah, we're just being paranoid, but then something else will happen that makes you question, the main character again. Then what is all that?
Yeah, but the problem I had with that, this is where I thought it had problems with the script itself. Or how they structured it. A lot of things that I know they wanted you, the audience, to try to guess, is this guy just being paranoid or does he have something there? But the problem was there was stuff that was happening there where anybody would have wound up being paranoid the way he was.
And yet he
and I was
to
confounded that
one.
Everyone else wasn't.
Yeah.
To the point where I thought, oh, they're all in on it.
Mm-hmm.
Which wasn't the case. And I don't think they set that up well.
Well, also, another problem, even though he's a great actor, it seems that whenever John Carroll Lynch is in the film,
yeah.
You all automatically know something's up.
Exactly. just casting him alone, you're like, unless you're waiting for some sort of twist.
Exactly.
But I guess it's the closest thing to a spoiler we can say about this film. If it's John Carroll Lynch, you're probably right as to what kind of character he's playing.
True.
But yeah, I mean, you liked it better than I did. I thought it was okay.
Yeah, I liked it a lot. Not top 10 material, but I really enjoyed it for what it was worth.
Know what I like better, though?
Oh, Lord.
That's available on Netflix right now? Hush. Have you seen that yet?
Yes, that's also on my list that I saw.
I thought that was actually surprisingly good.
I liked it because I didn't... because it's one of those films where you don't expect much because... The way the premise is set up, you think, oh, it's just going to be this slasher film. And then you think, oh, they'll add this twist. But then that twist actually ends up working out. It's something simple that actually makes the premise even more interesting. And you can do more things with it.
That's what I liked about it, too. You go into it thinking, oh, this is just, leave your brain at the door kind of thing. I heard, decent things about it. So that's why I was willing to check it out.
Mm-hmm.
And you expect it to be kind of like, them or this pseudo American remake of them, the Strangers. You expect it to be like these faceless, people trying to invade this person's house, you know, kind of thing. And we've seen a variation of this over and over and over again. In other words, you think it's going to be like a horror film or a torture porn film, right?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't become that at all. It becomes more of a thriller.
Yeah, because they throw out the faceless thing like the first 20 minutes.
Right, and it's actually a very well-done thriller. There's some gaps in logic there. You know, you have to suspend your disbelief. You know, like there are moments where you're like, oh, the character could have easily run away at this point. You know, things like that. But it's very well acted for what it is.
Yes, I highly recommend it.
Yeah, there's nothing about it feels cheap.
Yes, it's anti John Carpenter's feelings on Friday the 13th.
Yeah. So that's something we can definitely agree on. Should we get to the big ones? Let's start off with the earlier one, Batman versus Superman, Dawn of Justice.
Oh, jeez. Okay, I am not the biggest comic book fan, but I do try to keep up somewhat with comic books. But having said that, the movie had some interesting visuals, but that's all it had. There were just so many problems with the movie overall that I think I liked it maybe a little bit more than some of my other comic book loving friends, but it was pretty much a mess.
Well, some comic book loving fans loved it. It kind of polarized comic book fans in a way. I would say that I liked it better than I thought I would too, but I went in with really low expectations.
Right. As did I.
But I agree with you. It is a mess. Structurally, it's just a mess.
I mean, and we don't really have to get into the things that half the memes and people have been making jokes about. Like, oh, the stupid plot turn of, like, your mom's name is Martha, too?
Yeah.
Like, really?
Yeah, that was painful.
Or, you know, just natural questions like, you know where Lois Lane is every second of the day, but you didn't know your mother got kidnapped?
Well, the way it is, I could sum it up, what my feelings about the film is with one sequence. You've all probably seen the movie by now. It's the dream sequence. We think it's a dream sequence. Maybe it's a prophecy. Who knows? But it's quite possibly, in the movie, it's quite possibly most stunningly shot, stunningly conceived. It's wonderfully weird, and yet it makes no sense. And that's Batman versus Superman as a whole. The film makes no fucking sense from beginning to end. What exactly is Lex Luthor's plan?
I don't know, because it seems to have changed in the middle of it.
Yeah, and so is he like? So it turns out he's actually being controlled by, shall we say, this is the other thing. Is he being controlled by this thing that was alluded to in Bruce Wayne's vision/dream? That's probably Darkseid. Yet no one's ever fucking heard of Darkseid unless you're a hardcore comic fan, right? Like that stuff didn't make any sense. No one still has given me an answer to why the fuck does Batman brand his criminal victims?
Oh, I have no idea.
What does that do?
They kept just saying, like, that's the mark of death in jail.
How is it the mark and death in jail? Most of the criminals are captured by Batman and they all have that fucking brand on them.
I have no
if
idea.
Anything that would band them together to want to get revenge on Batman, right?
If we were using logic, yes.
Why, if Bruce Wayne has been Batman for a while, right, mm-hmm. Why are the cops still scared of him? At this point, wouldn't they view him as an ally?
I have no idea.
Is Gotham City right across the
that
river
was gonna be
from,
my question.
From Metropolis?
I was like, it's right there, and yet Superman can only take care of Metropolis?
Batman vs. Superman is a kind of film where a bunch of executives got together with a guy was put in charge, maybe guys or girls, who are too fanboy-esque to the point where they don't have a capability of exploring themes beyond the concept of, oh, I'm such a fan of this issue, I'm such a fan of this story arc, I'm just going to replicate that aspect. That, for me, is the thing all fanboys want to masturbate to. And I'm going to figure out a way to put that in the movie. I'm going to figure out a way to put this other thing in a movie. I'm going to figure out a way to put this other thing in a movie. And we'll worry about structuring a plot around it later. You know, because this is what the fans want to see. Right? And, you know, like you have that scene when he pushes the nuke out of the way and explodes. It's straight out of Frank Miller's Dark Knight Returns. You know, okay, we get it. We get it.
And don't forget the Doomsday thing.
The Doomsday thing.
Where he flies him into space and then flies him all the way back down.
The Doomsday thing. You know, the Martha thing didn't bother me as much as a scene where after he's fought off all those thugs to save Martha Kent, he says to her, "Oh, I'm your son's friend." What? But this is the thing. Let's talk about the good.
Okay.
Let's talk about the good of the film.
This should be a short conversation.
I did think there were moments there where I'm like, you know what? If Snyder really focused and got a better screenwriter and trusted that screenwriter, there are elements there where I saw how it could have been a really good movie. For example, this is the first thing that comes to mind. When I alluded to the scene where he like tells Martha Kent that he's his son friend, that ruined a fantastic scene that led up to that. That was a fight scene.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best fight scene Zack Snyder has ever directed. It doesn't employ his usual cheap tricks like the ramping up, you know, slow motion and all that stuff. It was just good old fashioned choreography. Just let the camera show off his fantastic choreography, and that was really well done. Really well done. You know, I liked the aspects where they were going with this particular permutation of Bruce Wayne, and I loved Jeremy Irons' take on you know,
Alfred.
Alfred. Yeah, I was gonna say Albert. Alfred. You know, I like that. I liked where they're going with that. I think though, there were like moments there where they lingered too long on Ben Affleck's, you know,
workout,
depressed or whatever. It was like to the point where you like half expected Affleck at any moment to yell, "Okay, cut already," you know. you know, little things like that were kind of would like it start off really well and then it'd be ruined by another moment. I thought Wonder Woman was okay. That's the one thing everyone was like, "Oh, Wonder Woman's awesome in this." Anyone could have played her.
Well, I was more dazzled by Gal Gadot's beauty more than anything else.
But I was like, you cast Gal Gadot, you could have cast anyone in that part, really. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, yeah, it conceptually she was cool. But I'm like, okay, this person is how old now, and she still has an accent that you can barely understand her English, you know, that kind of thing. But also, yeah, the other stuff too, like the little silly stuff. Like okay, again, P's a fanboy, so give people a little preview, teaser of what they're going to see in a future DCU, right?
Oh, yes.
Right? I love how Lex Luthor hired a graphics design firm to come up with all these logos to represent each new hero. But, yeah, there's just stuff there that was just... It was almost like this was like Zack Snyder's Batman Forever or Batman and Robin in a lot of ways. It went so far from Man of Steel to being so overtly comic booky and unintentionally campy in a lot of ways.
Well, that would be just Jesse Eisenberg throughout.
And poor Henry Cavill, man. What the hell are they doing with that Superman character? You know, it's just... what a depressing, selfish character they've turned him into. It's just,
Well, the scene I just thought was stupid was, most have probably seen this film already. The courthouse explosion.
Yeah.
Because he just, like, stands there for, like, 5 minutes, just shaking his head, like, that's all you're going to do at this point.
And why does everyone automatically assume it was his fault?
I guess because as he explains later, oh, I should have sensed it. If I wasn't thinking about Lois, I would have noticed.
And Lex Luthor creates this creature called Doomsday, who is causing more destruction than Batman and Superman could ever do. How was that his plan? How was he going to control him?
I don't know, but it seemed like he was intent on I guess he thought he could control him by giving him his DNA.
Was that what was going on? That wasn't clear either. The whole thing is just, the whole film is just, when you think about it, is a mess. It's a mess.
And this is supposed to be the stepping stone of which the others are built upon.
And there was this interesting, you know, they set up this interesting idea that Bruce Wayne has this one attitude towards, you know, superpower beings. They need to be put in check. You've got this other side of it that, yeah, but you're a vigilante. Aren't you being kind of hypocritical? But they never really explore that. And they don't, and to the point where it doesn't justify why Bruce Wayne is so mad at Superman. Okay, he saw a bunch of people die in his building. I get that. That should be the motivator right there. But when you start getting into, like, how can our heroes be unchecked and all that stuff, even Bruce Wayne isn't stupid enough to realize that he's being hypocritical when he makes that criticism. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So there has to be a smarter way to go about this than what they came up with in this film.
Well, that would be held for a better writer.
Right. So, anyway, so apparently, getting to some news, apparently Warner Brothers was a little taken aback by the response, a critical response. The film did well, it made money, but didn't make as much as they had projected.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's been a shakeup, apparently, at Warner Brothers, in terms of, like, I know Jeff Johns is going to have more of a sort of authority over the direction, along with another guy whose name escapes me.
Okay.
I guess they're going to be sort of like the Kevin Feige now.
Okay.
We lost a director for the Flash film, so we're going to replace him.
Okay.
But Snyder's still doing Justice League, and they announced that Ben Affleck will direct a Batman movie.
Yes, that I hear he also is writing.
Yeah, with his screenwriter who wrote Argo, who also co-wrote Batman versus Superman, so that doesn't really bode well.
Well, you know? At least it's not David Goyer who helped co-write Batman versus Superman, but interestingly enough, helped write the Christopher Nolan Batman films.
Yeah, Goyer's hit or miss for me. You know, I mean, I had this conversation with our buddy Mike Fultz, actually, and he was like, "Well, Goyer's done some good stuff." I go, "Well, what? Blade?"
There you go. That's pretty much his
authority.
You
know, I mean, yeah, he was involved in Batman Begins, you know, and all that stuff. But even then, I mean, I love Batman Begins. And I love The Dark Knight. Not a big fan of Dark Knight Rises.
Very few are.
But even then, I agree. I will concede that there are still issues with the screenplay. The screenplay is only because that's a Nolan thing. Nolan loves exposition, and he has a terrible sense of humor, you know, and everything's always dour and ponderous, you know, all that stuff. And a lot of that comes, a lot of that is because he tends to rely on the same writers a lot. And Goyer might have contributed some of that to that. I know his brother wrote some of them as well.
Yeah.
But I see some of those same issues with Nolan's Batman films in the current Zack Snyder versions as well. So I wonder if that was more or less attributed to Goyer than to Nolan, but who knows. But anyways, yeah. Now, comparing that to something like Captain America Civil War, which plays with similar themes.
Better.
Yeah, it was a better film. A better film. It was a really fun movie. Is it a perfect film? No.
No. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely not. I wouldn't even say it was the best Marvel film.
No.
But it was. It did what it needed to do right and did it better. And I was shocked at how well they incorporated all the other characters.
Well, to me, this felt more to me like a better Avengers movie than Avengers Age of Ultron, even though it's more, you know, obviously in title alone, it's supposed to be more of a Captain America.
Yeah, I agree.
But I enjoyed every aspect of it, you know, Hawkeye, whatever. But, you know, every other character I felt had an interesting arc, even if it was minor. And, of course, the introduction of Spider-Man, where it finally feels like Marvel didn't really control the character when Sony had it. But it feels like this is at least the best interpretation, or it feels a little more correct with the comic book state of the character.
I thought I already had heard before going in how awesome the new Spider-Man is.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But I was really impressed. I was really impressed with the actor playing him. I think more than anything else, I love whether or not you want to make an argument that they nailed the comic book character or not. I don't really care about that. I thought he was an interesting character, period. I like how they set him up.
And he fits in. Totally.
And he fits in. I like how previous iterations, film iterations of Spider-Man, he tends to be really cocky
mm-hmm.
in his humor, show-offy. Whereas in this one, it's more like he uses it as a defense mechanism, which I thought was kind of interesting, where he is genuinely in awe of what he's doing and the people he is engaged with. You know, and that whole thing, and watching the other characters' reactions to him was pretty priceless. like Winter Soldier and,
Falcon?
Falcon's, yeah, I was going to say Hawkeye. Falcon's response to this guy as they're trying to control, you know, like trying to beat him back was pretty
mm-hmm.
humorous. They just didn't know, like how to respond to this guy, you know. And I thought they incorporated Ant-Man pretty well.
Yeah, that was, I mean, knew it was coming, but I thought that was a lot of fun more
yeah.
than anything. I like how they introduced Black Panther also.
Yes. Yeah, I'll go on record and say I was never a Black Panther fan. The concept never appealed to me. But
mm-hmm.
seeing this, I cannot wait to see the Black Panther movie.
Well, that, to me, was always going to be the major challenge is, I guess, trying to make a more minor Marvel character, you know, come more alive on the screen. But my thing was, they managed to do that with, to me, other minor characters in the Marvel universe. So I had high hopes, and I wasn't, you know, disappointed with the presentation.
No, Chadwick Boseman is great in the role.
Oh, yeah, he's
brings
a good actor,
lot
even
of dignity,
in, like, that
you know, and respect, and he has a lot of presence, you know, and it's just like, I was like, wow, I can't wait to see this movie. This is a really cool character, you know, so that was very impressive to me. I thought they handled the whole thing. I thought they did a really good job of incorporating everybody. I thought that, Downey Jr. was very good in it. I liked how they've like kept true to his arc throughout the entire series,
mm-hmm.
where he's a little darker now. his humor is more tinged with anger and fear, you know, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. I did like the, well, it's minor, but I like the digital effects of the early scene when he's going back into his memories and making Robert.
Oh, that
Downey
was creepy.
Yeah, but I thought that was amazing, because I was like, wow, it does look exactly like him when he was younger. And
It's like Downey Jr. had to walk off the set of Weird Science to shoot this like little bit for a film that won't come out until like 3 or 4 decades later. You know?
I was
it was
like,
placed in a time capsule.
Amazing.
Okay, Downey, we're putting this film out now, so we're going to use the scene we shot, you know, 40 years ago. It was very creepy. It was creepy in the same way. It was like what they did with Michael Douglas and Ant-Man.
Oh, yeah.
Even though for some reason it was less creepy because he's an adult. They de-aged him, but he was still an adult. Whereas here, you know, Downey Jr. is a kid again. It was weird. What do you think of the primary villain, Zemo, Captain Zemo, in the comics of Baron Zemo?
I know a lot of people complain, but I mean,
I didn't mind him.
To me, he was needed to set forth this, like, little bomb to have them go against each other and bring up these questions. And since I'm a fan of actor Daniel Brühl, I have no problem with his, you know, characterization, especially when at the end his full plan is more revealed. And so,
yeah, and I thought, you know, his motivation was really interesting. You know, it was believable. He was an interesting character. You know, you got the sense that, you know, in another life he could have been like a super spy or something like that, a la Jason Bourne.
Yeah.
You know, but
and Cap, and yeah, they gave Captain America some romance.
Which was funny. The audience I saw it with was a packed audience, and there was a group of people sitting behind me that were a lot of fun. I gotta be honest. if you haven't seen the film, spoiler, Peggy Carter's niece.
Yeah, niece.
Right.
Grandniece,
who was introduced in the previous Captain America film. They actually kiss. They had a romantic moment. But the minute that happened, one of the guys behind me yells out, "But your aunt just died!"
It's a fantasy film. Let it go.
Which was true, but there you go. Now, maybe that was Civil War's Martha moment. I don't know. But so there you go. But I thought it was very enjoyable. I had a good time with it.
I'm not going to nitpick. Like, oh, what happened to Scarlet Witch's accent?
I love the dynamic between Tony Stark and Aunt May.
No, the flirty type relationship.
I love that. I love how, like, the writers knew going in that the fans would be like, oh, Marissa Tomei's too hot to play Aunt May. And they kind of played off that in the film.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was hilarious, actually. I'm really looking forward to seeing this new iteration of Spider-Man. I hope it lives up to its potential. Because what preview we saw in that film, I thought was very encouraging. Same with Black Panther.
Yeah, I'm like, everything... And like I said, it's the anti-Batman vs. Superman. Everything seems promising here. And whereas with Batman vs. Superman and their spinoffs, it's a little more questionable.
But you know, you were paid by Marvel to say that, right?
Of course.
Full transparency, we were paid by Marvel to harsh on Warner Brothers DC properties.
Yes, because we're the only ones who feel this way.
Exactly. So, anything else that hit your radar that's, like, sort of newish and you saw Green Room. I still haven't seen that yet.
Oh, that is my number one film of the year so far.
Yeah, I just haven't had the opportunity to check it out. I really want to see it.
I think you'd enjoy it. It's one of those films where, from beginning to end, nonstop tension.
Wow.
And I will just warn you, if you're not that great with violence, this is not a movie you need to go see, because it's pretty graphic.
Okay, well, since I haven't seen that, we can't discuss it really, but I want to.
I know.
You did a review on The Lobster recently.
Yes.
We can talk about that.
Oh, okay. Haven't we talked about this before?
We sort of did. I don't know how much detail we went into it.
Okay.
I thought it was hilarious until it kept going on and on and on.
See, I think I really dug the love story until it just started, the, like, ridiculous aspects of the love story, jealousy and betrayal, started going around in, like, a weird circle. Then it was just like, really, all this?
Yeah, well, it's kind of like, it reminds me of the kind of work that, what's his name, the French director, the guy who did Rubber.
Oh, I don't know his name off the top of my head. Is it Xavier something?
Yeah, it kind of reminded me of his work, and that it's, like, really absurdist. Absurdist.
Yeah, I will agree that this was absurdist, but to me, the difference between those two is that, at least with, I'm not even going to try and attempt to say the director's name, but his is a little more emotional, even though his previous films I respect but was never a huge fan of, like, Alps and Dogtooth. I always thought they had great ideas,
yeah,
but I just never really got into the follow.
Yeah.
Though
I mean,
like
I enjoyed the lobster.
More than I liked Altered.
I enjoyed the lobster. I just felt it was like maybe 15 minutes too long and just kept going on and on and on. But I think that, you know, the cast was really game. Colin Farrell, I used to think the guy was an idiot.
I never got that. See, I've always liked
him. No. I used to not be a Colin Farrell fan. I just thought he was like a, you know, guy that was lucky. He was good-looking enough to be cast in key parts, but I was like, where's the talent? In Bruges completely changed my mind about him, and since then, I see him getting increasingly better.
And
he was the best thing in the last season of True Detective.
I agree. You're not going to get many arguments.
And I know that's not saying much, but he was damn good in the last season of True Detective. He was that good.
And supposedly he was a replacement for Jason Clarke in this movie.
Really interesting.
Yeah.
That's interesting, because he's really good in The Lobster.
He is, but the scene stealer, even though it's kind of obvious, John C. Reilly.
Yeah, John C. Reilly's very funny in it, too. I agree.
With his lisp. And,
yeah, no, I totally agree with that.
And I've always just found Ben Whishaw, he's a good actor, but I've always found him kind of strange. An actor. Something about him.
I think he's a very good actor. I think he's a very good actor.
He has a creepy presence.
We're going to see more of him, I'm sure. You know, I thought he was very good in this. I thought actually the entire cast was obviously they were into it, they were game, they're having a good time. Just being silly, you know, basically.
And Rachel Weisz, as always.
Rachel Weisz, yeah, you know. Lea Seydoux.
She's in a lot of stuff.
She's in a lot of stuff lately, yeah. But, yeah, so you have all of them. I don't know the name of the French actress that played the sort of one of the housemaids of the hotel.
No, she's actually Greek because she was
she's
in...
Greek?
Yeah, she was in Before Midnight.
Okay, so she's Greek.
And she's been in all his previous films, too. That's the only reason I remember
Interesting. Yeah. There's moments where she goes, you know, one of the things they have to do is they have to, like, sexually arouse some of the gases part. I don't know. Should we explain what this movie's about?
We can try.
You can't spoil this movie. It's because it's not, like, that kind of film. It's just, it takes place in what might be a dystopian future, alternate reality, whatever, where people, I guess, like, you have to find love.
Yes, and couple up. Or if by a certain amount of time you haven't, you will be reincarnated as an animal of your choice.
Yeah. Yes, you'll be reincarnated as animal of your choice. In Colin Farrell's example, he wants to be reincarnated as a lobster, hence why the movie's called The Lobster. But it's not something you take literally. It's just an absurdist piece. It's like a Buñuel film, like a Louis Buñuel film, you know, from like the 60s and 70s. It's
yes.
Like nothing makes sense, and that's part of the humor, you know. It's like on one side you're allowed to experience love, but it's under strict restrictions, or you'll die. The alternative is that you have freedom, but you're not allowed to experience love. So there's like all these like, and it's, yeah. So, anyway, so that's The Lobster.
It's very European.
Yeah, it has a very European feel, even though it's a very international cast.
Yes.
So, anything else that might have, like, fallen on everyone's radar recently?
Would Team Foxcatcher, the documentary, fall on everyone's radar?
I have not seen that yet, and I want to.
Let me put it to you this way. It's, to me, it's a different animal, but I'm more enjoyable than Foxcatcher the movie.
Okay. All right.
I just
remembered the film that I saw that you recommended, so continue.
Oh, okay. No, I found it gives more insight to the whole situation. It paints a different picture than the film Foxcatcher, because in the film Foxcatcher, it just made it seem like he had this relationship with the amateur brother, and then the older, more professional brother came in and was like the go-between between the two brothers, almost like it was their own little love story. In this documentary, it shows that he was always more close with the older brother, who was the more professional, and that more everybody took care of I can't remember his name. The main character.
The main character is an arrestor or the millionaire? Billionaire.
The millionaire. Who, in his own way, is like a less creepy version of Robert Durst. But you could tell there's something a little off there. And, I mean, they interview everybody now, and it has a kind of an interesting twist at the end. I mean, you know what happened, but I found this, like, last act that they never even approached or talked about in the movie very interesting. I don't want to ruin it.
Okay. Well, that's on my Netflix queue.
Okay, that's the one I definitely would suggest, especially if you're really into documentaries.
It's like I have to, like, watch them when Michelle's not around, because she's not crazy about documentaries.
Okay.
Kind of thing. And I usually don't have time to watch a film when she's not around.
Oh, okay.
So it's one of those things where I have to work that out. What I saw was Beast of No Nation.
Finally!
And it was excellent. It was very, very good.
Told you.
Very good. I heard of it, but I didn't know much about it except where it's set. I know Idris Elba was in it, and he was supposed to be good in it. I didn't realize what I didn't know going into it was how focused it was on the kid. It's really his movie.
Oh, okay.
But yes. I thought it was really good. And everyone's talking about Idris Elba. Yes, he's fantastic in it. No doubt. Everybody's good in this film. Everybody.
Oh, yes.
It reminded me a lot of Empire of the Sun in some ways. I know it's a different setting, but it deals with, like, this point of view of this kid who's thrust into the situation where he has to learn how to survive it, and it changes him. And then he winds up in a somewhat, maybe, peaceful situation at the very end.
Yeah, that was this, like, little glimmer of hope. And
yeah.
After you basically go through hell through most of the film.
But I thought it was very, very well done. Very good.
I thought, considering, I mean, before was True Detective, and then the film Sinombre, and I know the director had directed a remake of a classic literary adaptation. I don't remember which one off the top of my head. But, I mean, this to me is his most impressive film work that I've seen.
He's about to do the Stanley Kubrick Napoleon.
Yeah, the miniseries.
Right? Yeah. This is the guy who was going to do the It movie.
Yeah, and then dropped out.
But anyways, Cary Fukunaga? Or Fukunaga?
Yes. Fukunawa, I think.
Okay. Did I say Corey or Cary? It's Cary, right?
It's Cary.
Cary Fukunaga. Okay, so anyways. So I think he's good. I think he has a lot of promise. You know, I'm interested to see where he goes with his career. Who knows? I'm trying to think of anything else. I think that's it.
Out of the bigger movies, yeah.
Yeah, the more whole high profile stuff.
Go ahead. Oh, no, there was one film I also wanted to mention that I just want all people to go see this, because it is my number two movie of the year so far. Sing Street.
Sing Street, okay.
By the director of Once and Begin Again.
I loved Once.
I
did not like Begin Again as much.
See, I'm the reverse way. I love Begin Again. Once was okay. But this film, I don't know. I just cried at the end. This film's beautiful. It's a coming-of-age tale, yada, yada, yada. But I have a weakness for good coming-of-age films. And, you know, it has the typical boy meets girl. He starts a band to impress her, but then actually discovers he has musical talent. And their little love story. And it's, you know, one of those films, don't give up on your dreams. And it's set during the 80s. And his older brother helps him discover different music. And then he starts dressing in these different musical styles also as he's writing songs in these different musical styles. And, you know, the kids can actually play instruments and sing, and it's just impressive. The humor's where it should be, the heart's where it should be. I understand this might not make everybody else's top 10 of the list just for style or content, but this one really touched me. So
I've heard good things about it. It's gotten positive word of mouth, so.
Yeah, I really love this film. I mean, I even have the soundtrack, and I can't listen to one song because it makes me get too emotional. But one, there's just one sequence in this that reminded me so much of Back to the Future and an 80s music video, like perfectly combined, that to me, it's like the highlight of the film for me personally.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's the only film. Like, I have other films, but high profile. It's a film I think needs an audience, or at least to get discovered a little bit more.
The only thing I could add to this that might be interesting, I'm doing my, like, adventures in revisiting old TV series.
Uh-oh.
or oldish.
Okay.
And we started going through Angel, the Josh Whedon series, spinoff to Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Oh, I know.
We're at the final season now.
Now, you've seen the final season before, though, right?
I remember seeing bits and pieces of the final season, but I don't recall seeing everything all the way through.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting. Some of it is really entertaining and really fun how it, like, sort of nudge winks at the genre, and some of it's just really dumb and cheesy.
Well, that was back in the you-gotta-fill 22 episodes days.
It's just an interesting experiment we're dealing with, and it's not bad.
The only thing I've ever had a problem with is that just knowing that David Boreanaz is not that great an actor.
Yes and no. Sometimes he's really good in this, and sometimes it's just he's sort of just phoning it in. You know, it depends on who he's performing a scene with. There's certain actors that, like, actually make him look better, where he becomes a little bit alive. And there are certain scenes where he's just kind of just there posing. but that's the thing that actually surprised me. I don't remember him being as loose. He gets really loose in some scenes, looser than he ever did in the Buffy series, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where the character seems to be having more fun, even though he's not supposed to be. But there's other things too, like the Lindsay character. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know.
I'm just like, whoa, that's like the worst casting I've ever seen. This guy has no charisma, no presence. He doesn't even come across as remotely a threat at all. Why do you keep pushing this character like he should be this canon character that everyone wants to see again? I don't get that. I also, this attempt to try to push Cordelia and Angel together just doesn't work.
Well, it was forced, and I guess since she was like the only other crossover, it just felt like...
That's what it felt like.
Naturally, they should be together.
However, in this last season, I remember thinking, oh, the last season jumped the shark. It got really stupid when they took over Wolfram and Hart. I'm actually surprised by how much more I'm enjoying the final season than anything before it. Actually. It's so wacky. I'm even surprised at how much I'm okay with, like, them bringing Spike in. Because that actually works.
I always like Spike's character.
So anyway, that's what the other projects we're engaged in. We're revisiting Angel, and we're almost done with that.
There's one more I want to mention. Nice Guys.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Nice Guys. I have to see that. I want to see it so bad.
You will love it. It is very good.
Yeah, Nice Guys in Green Room.
I have to say, I think so far Ryan Gosling has given one of the top comedic performances of the year in that film.
Yeah, I hear he's amazing in it. I hear he's really, really good. And I can't wait to see it. I really can't. Since Andre's not with us, we thought that, well, we were going to talk about films recently seen. We kind of like plowed through that. It actually happened a little quicker because we don't have a third person. You know, their input and what they've seen. So we could talk about some recent news items, because we haven't done this in like a month. There's like been a lot of news announcements about a lot of things. So we're just going to stick to like maybe two or three things that have happened in the past week that have people buzzing. one of which, you know, our favorite topic, James Bond. We talk about this all the time, but there's been talk about, granted, it was the Daily Mail who reported this, you know, not the most trustworthy news source, but they were saying that, Daniel Craig is not coming back. They're trying to make him an offer to make him stay. He may not want to do that. Following that, there was rumors that they're going to go for Tom Hiddleston because he had lunch with, Sam Mendes. Like, that means anything? Then we got this news report that the producers met with, Jamie Bell.
Yeah, that one I didn't expect.
And now, as early as, not yesterday, but the day before Birth Movie's death, that used to be Badass Digest. The Draft House Films cinema blog, they reported that they had a source, a source close to Hiddleston or Eon or whomever, say yes, they are in talks with Tom Hiddleston. So, this is my response to all that. Nothing means anything yet. If Craig is out, this kind of speculation happens all the fucking time. The last time they recast Bond, everyone was talking about Clive Owen.
Oh, yes.
And he wasn't even someone they even approached. Right? This is my thing. Traditionally, Eon, when they cast a new actor to play Bond, they go in one or two directions. They either go with someone that's very unknown, to the point of not really having had a career, George Lazenby, or someone who's had a career but isn't well known, Timothy Dalton, and Sean Connery, or someone that is well known but well known for being on TV or doing the occasional B movie, like Roger Moore at the time of his career, Pierce Brosnan at the time of his career. In other words, actors who need a second act to their career when their first act is sort of drying up. The reason why they do that is because it's expensive casting someone to play the leading role in one of the most iconic franchises in history and getting them to commit to at least three movies, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're not going to go for a big name star. That's why I don't think, you know, we'd love to see Fassbender play the part. I don't think it's going to happen because he doesn't need it.
And
he's going to command a lot of money.
And he's too busy.
He's too busy. That's why I'm kind of not, I'm still skeptical about the Tom Hiddleston thing. Yes, Hiddleston's put out there he would love to play the role.
Mm-hmm. But that's,
but he's veering into that. He's kind of treads that line of being that sort of Roger Moore, Pierce Brosnan public eye visibility to being in a position where he could probably command what he wants right now. It's not like he needs a second act to his career. It's like his career is growing.
Right? Yeah.
And he's already like Loki, you know, he's already doing this other stuff.
So he has a fan base.
And even though they might be talking with him, even though, yeah, and a lot of fans want him, but, you know, God, Hiddleston has a fierce fan base. but also, you know, he may have put out there that he wants to play the role, but whether or not he'll be willing to do it is an entirely different story. And in order to want to do that, you have to ask, well, what kind of commitment do you want from me? How many films are we going to do back to back? How much are you going to pay me? How much do you want me to promote this? Because I'm going to be the face of the brand for a good part of the decade. You know, that kind of thing. How will this prevent me from doing other roles? You know, this is a lot of stuff you have to consider. And so usually they go with someone. My thing is like, maybe it's going to be Hiddleston. I personally wouldn't mind if they cast him in the part. I'm not mm-hmm. blown away by the idea. I think he's too on the nose.
Okay.
A little too obvious. It's kind of like when they cast Pierce Brosnan. I was like, oh, surprise. He played Remington Steele. He looks like a Saturday morning cartoon idea of what a James Bond would look like. You know, that kind of thing. I'm not saying that's Hiddleston. It's just like Hiddleston because he's British, he's good looking, he can be suave. I just think it's kind of an obvious choice. I don't think it's that imaginative. But I think he's a good enough actor where he can pull off. Question is, what kind of James Bond will he be? Will he be more brutal and thuggish like Craig, or will he go back to the more light, Roger Moore-esque stuff, or would it be somewhat in between, like Pierce Brosnan? Who knows? But I personally think that should they be casting for a new Bond, provided that Daniel Craig has not quit the role, I would say look at someone that's younger, look at someone that's not quite in the public eye, but's kind of getting there, someone who does a lot of TV, someone who does maybe do a lot of independent film. I'm saying look at people like Jack O'Connell. Look at people like Rupert Friend.
I would say pushing Rupert Friend.
I would be very, very, very surprised if Dan Stevens is on their radar right now.
I can see that, especially if they've seen The Guest.
Even though he's a little on the nose, I would be very surprised if they weren't seriously considering him.
But my question, can Rupert Friend even be considered since he had, what was it, The Hitman series?
No, but he wasn't, but it's not public eye. I mean, Roger Moore had The Saint and The Persuaders. Oh. Pierce Brosnan had Remington Steele and a lot of made-for-TV movies, right? Mm-hmm. Look, Roger Moore and Pierce Brosnan were somewhat household names before they played Bond.
Okay.
Rupert Friend is not a household name.
No.
Right? But he is a very good actor. I mean, he's a very good actor. Have you seen Startup?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's very good in that. He's transformative. I would say that he's kind of like Daniel Craig, and that Daniel Craig, before he played Bond, was more of a character actor who could play leading man parts. You know, Rupert Friend kind of falls into that. I think Luke Evans could be a contender.
He'd be a rougher-looking Bond.
Well, I mean, not as rough as Daniel Craig. Daniel Craig's probably the roughest-looking Bond we've had next to Connery. Right?
Looking at all the others. Yeah.
I mean, Craig looks like he's been chiseled out of rock. But I could see Evans doing it, or them considering Evans. He's at that stage in his career. Even though he did Dracula Untold, it might be part of this Universal cinematic universe.
Yeah, I think he'll be able to get out of that.
Yeah, I can't see why, you know, he wouldn't be on their radar. I've heard other mentions of other actors that people I'd never even heard before, but are somewhat popular in England because of the TV work they're currently doing. You never know.
Is Idris Elba totally out of the mix?
You know what? To me, Idris Elba is this era's Clive Owen.
Okay.
In terms of the wish fulfillment fantasy of who people would like to see play Bond.
Mm-hmm.
I would love to see Idris Elba play Bond. I think he'd be awesome. I just don't think he'll be young enough by the time
they finally get around to it.
Yeah, because he's in his late 40s now.
Mid to late 40s. I was like early 40s.
Maybe. I think he's about 45 at least. Mm. No, he looks great. By the time they get around to actually doing that film, he's going to be close to 50 years old, and that means he won't have that many films left to do. You know? That's the only thing I would have against that. I think he's like this year's. It's I would say it's a toss up between him and Fassbender as being this era. You know, this year's Clive Owen wish fulfillment. We want this guy to play Bond,
okay.
Amongst fans. But yeah, I if it's Hiddleston, fine. I won't complain. I won't be blown away by it. You know, at least with Daniel Craig, at first I was like, wow, I don't see that, but wow, that's such an interesting choice. I want to see how this pans out, you know? With Jamie Bell, I'll definitely be thinking that if he cast him. Although, I don't see that at all. I wonder if that's even fucking true. Although, Eon does have a habit of, like, talking to any actor that does a British accent just because.
Okay.
And sometimes they do that traditionally according to, like, the history of prior, like, you know, when they went through the casting process. Sometimes they do it to try to, like, light a fire on the butt of the current actor playing Bond to try to force them to make a decision finally. Well, are you going to play this? Because we're looking at this actor, and he's interested in doing it. We're looking at that actor, and he's willing to do it. You got to tell us yes or no. And they did this with Roger Moore twice. Okay. That was what the whole James Brolin thing was all about.
Okay.
When they were going to cast James Brolin as Bond, right? even though it was probably really a ploy to try to get Roger Moore to finally decide whether he's going to return to the role or not. And he did for two more films, even though he's too fucking old for the part at that point. So, you never know. You never know. I personally want Craig to do one more Bond film because I want him to leave the series on a high note.
Yeah, I saw Spectre recently.
Oh, you finally saw it?
Yeah.
Oh, this, well, what'd you think?
Coming
from a person that's not, like, a Bond fan, so you're not steeped in the history and all that stuff?
It was, thank God it was better than Quantum of Solace, but I had problems, I guess, like, well, I can say spoilers at this point, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah, everyone's
like,
seen it by now, except for Mike Foltz.
Okay, because I'm like, I guess the reveal of the villain, again, was so obvious, and the way he's played, he's just so weaselly. And one action sequence I never fully understood, which was when the thugs are trying to take Q off of the ski lift. I think I missed something.
Well, what was it that you missed? What was it?
I didn't see how he got away.
Oh, he got away. Oh, wait, no. Didn't he get away? Like he snuck out with a whole bunch of. People with, you know, a bunch of people with skis came in and he snuck out with them.
I don't remember because all I remember was since they were cross-cutting between that action sequence and Bond's action sequence, I was more, you know, indebted to Bond's action sequence that I barely even remember how Q got away. I just remember him being safe and clear. And I was like, how did he get away? And,
yeah, I hated the whole thing. Blofeld was James Bond's foster brother thing. Yeah, I just hated that so much.
And it was, like, done out of... All this was done more out of jealousy
which
than
made
else.
No sense. Every single thing. And also, this is the thing. I won't take credit for this. I read this in another criticism. I totally agree with it. It renders Bond useless as a secret agent now. He's now a liability to the British Secret Service. Because every single fucking mission he's done has all been about him. So he can't work anymore. Thank you, Spectre. You know, it was I hated that. They didn't need to do that. It was stupid. I hated that they wanted to, like, I knew they were trying to pay visual homage to the original Blofelds, but I hated they were still wearing that same jacket. I hated that they didn't. I would have loved to have gone back to the Blofeld of the novels. You know, he was a much more interesting character than he's been in the movies. I hated that they gave him a facial scar. Like, that's canon. It's not. The only reason why Donald Pleasance had a facial scar and you only lived twice is because Donald Pleasance was cast in the last minute. They replaced him with the actor that originally was cast to play Blofeld. Because they found out the actor didn't know how to speak English. And so Donald Pleasance was the only actor available. They threw him in there because Donald Pleasance didn't look menacing enough because he's not a big guy. They threw a scar on his face to make him look menacing. I shit you not. Okay? Not that I didn't like Donald Pleasance in the part. He was perfectly okay.
Understandable. But
Telly Savalas as Blofeld didn't have a scar. Charles Gray as Blofeld didn't have a scar. You know, but that they felt the need to give him that inspector, I just thought was so lame and so unimaginative. And I don't know. I was really, really disappointed with that. Having said that, I'm glad you saw it.
There will be a written review coming up.
I hope,
me.
Like I said, I want Daniel Craig to have one more. To go out with a bang. Because he deserves it. Because he, you know, say what you will about Spectre and Quantum of Solace. He is instrumental in the direction that the Bonds went, that where they needed to go at this point.
I agree.
He helped make them interesting again. And he made Bond an interesting character, you know?
Now he made me interested in actually seeing the films. Also the quality of the film. But I think that's because I really liked Skyfall.
Skyfall and Casino Royale. Casino Royale, yes. I, you know, now I can look back on it, had some distance from it. I consider it one of the best Bond films ever made. I think it's technically probably the best made Bond film. Skyfall has script issues for me.
Okay.
But I think it's probably the best directed, the best photographed, in some ways has the best dialogue in the Bond series. I think the dialogue in that film is exceptional.
Well, my favorite is still, God, I can never remember the title, though. The one with Yaphet Kotto.
Oh, Live and Let Die. Live and Let Die is a lot of fun.
Exactly. That's why it's my favorite.
So, let's get off the Bond thing track. Let's talk about... we could talk briefly about this Ghostbusters thing, because we've talked about it before. but it's interesting. The new trailers came out since we last podcast.
We've
had, like, a full trailer, and we've had, like, a UK version. UK version's better. Barely. I think that going into this, knowing that the studio was going to get a lot of flack for their approach to this film, I think they need to fire their PR department for the way they're marketing this film. Because they're doing a terrible fucking job.
I agree.
There must be a much more imaginative way to promote this film where you can get where you can say to people, look, we're going to change your mind. I know what you're thinking. We're going to show you this. And you're going to be like, you know what? That's cool. That does look interesting. I'm going to give this benefit of the doubt. And they're not doing that.
I think it's because they're more marketing it as a Paul Feig type film in the past.
To be honest, I don't think the film they're marketing is the film. When I look at the trailers, the thing that hit me is like, I'm willing to bet you that the film they're marketing isn't the film they made.
I hope so.
You know, that's the feeling I get when I watch those trailers, because the trailers aren't really doing anything. It's not really helping them. And there could have been, like, really cool, interesting ways to tease it. Hell, they could have done something like they did for Prometheus, right?
Oh, yeah.
Where they tease you with, like, online commercials for the Ghostbusters, you know. We're going to help you do this and that, whatever. You know, create this sort of reality around it. Do it in a really fun, viral way. And get you kind of excited. Okay, I like what they're doing. If they apply this kind of imagination towards promotion to the film, I'm on board. I'm going to give it benefit of the doubt. But instead, they just went about it in such a generic, predictable way that I think is actually working against whatever they made. Or, simply, the movie is really not going to be that good. Because what we're seeing in those trailers is, yeah, that's the film. That's how funny it is. You know? There you go. You know, which will be very, very sad.
Again, it's not showing a lot of promise if that is the fact.
What do you think of all this response to the Cinemassacre guy, the angry video game nerd?
It's his right to not watch the film if he doesn't want to. Again, I can understand some people have sacred cows, but I use the same argument that I used last year. I know you guys see this as a gimmick and all that, but to me, all reboots are gimmicks in of themselves. And you didn't have this outcry for Vacation, though some people consider that their classic growing up.
Or so, Terminator Genesis, or Total Recall, or RoboCop.
Exactly. And it's like, but you all went out and saw those and then complained. So my thing is, there's only one element in this that could make you so angry. And as usual, internet trolls... I understand Patton Oswalt has his own point of view, but you did not have to hit dirty so recently after his wife had died either. That was crossing a line.
Well, there's a couple of aspects to this. more than a couple. Starting off with that video as an example.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not really familiar with this guy. It's James Wolfe, I think his name is. Wolfe?
Yeah, I'm not.
With an R. I'm not familiar with his stuff. I just, you know, I watched the video because it was linked to that from an article that Devin Faraci of MoviesDeath.com wrote about soft sexism sometimes being part of the reason why fans are as, like, myopic as they are.
Mm-hmm.
Although it really wasn't about sexism. I thought it was a misleading title. It was really about the myopic nature of fans.
Okay.
You know, like how they don't want their sacred cows to be messed with. And, okay. He says, I'm not going to watch. He starts off his video by saying, I thought the trailer was awful, therefore I'm not going to watch or review this film. I just won't do it. Okay, fine. Leave it at that. But then he goes on this whole thing, which contradicts you know, like his defenders are saying, no, 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 he's not sexist. I'm not saying he's sexist. I don't think he is, actually. There's nothing in his video that suggests that he's coming from this from a sexist point. The problem is that he spends a lot of time and energy talking about his issues over film he hasn't even seen that are issues that have nothing to do with whatever problem you may have with this trailer. Where it goes into, basically, in a nutshell, this film is not the Ghostbusters film I want.
Okay,
I want a Ghostbusters film with the original cast. I want the original cast to pass the baton on to a new cast. I want the new Ghostbusters film to be directly connected to the original Ghostbusters franchise. Franchise, however, folks, say it loosely, there were only two Ghostbusters films. And the second one sucked. There's a TV series, the cartoon, and there was a video game. I guess it's a media franchise, right? But not a film franchise. All right? First Ghostbusters, I've said this many, many times. This is the other thing. The guy goes on and on as if this is fact. He goes on about how Ghostbusters is one of the greatest comedies ever made and is beloved the world over. Okay, that's the other problem I had with this thing. You know, before you say it, say that it's your opinion. Because the fact of the matter is, a lot of people do not think Ghostbusters is the greatest comedy ever made. It's a classic in the sense that it came out at a specific time and place where it resonated with a lot of people. No one had seen anything like that before. But having revisited it a couple times recently, it's okay. It's fun. But it's not one of the best comedies ever made. Really? You kidding me? you know, and I get the nostalgic value. I get that for a lot of people who have a certain age, it meant something to them. But you know what? It still exists. It's still there. The film isn't going away. You know, and he went on about this thing. It's like what he's also afraid of is that a new generation of people will think that this is their Ghostbusters and forget that this original one existed. And I'm just like, that's where he lost me. You know, I was like, maybe, maybe not. But even if it did, so what? You know, and this is the final question I have. You know, what if the film actually turns out to be good? What if it turns out to be really good? Then what are you going to do? Are you going to see that, change your mind and then see the film and review it? Or are you going to still hold your word? Because then this is not going to be about whether or not you have an open mind. This is about you being so myopic and your sense of entitlement and ownership over a sacred cow that isn't really that sacred to everybody, just to a certain fan base, like Trekkies or Dragon Ball Z fans. You know, it's like, that's where I'm just like, okay, this is, you know, this is where I get into that whole screed about nerds, stop making us nerds look bad. You know what I mean? So that's where I'm coming from. Did you actually watch his entire video?
No, I didn't watch it.
Okay, yeah, check it out and tell me, and feel free to disagree with me, but that's that's the impression I got. And when Devin Faraci mentioned soft sexism, what he meant was, this is what I interpreted from the article, and he says specifically in the article, just because you're not looking forward to new Ghostbusters does not mean I think you're sexist. He says that specifically. But he said, but ask yourself this question. Why do you have this problem, this violent response to something like Ghostbusters that you didn't have to, like, previous reboots and remakes? Texas Chainsaw Massacre, blah, 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 blah. You know?
Exactly.
Would you have as much of a problem with this if, say, it was cast with, you know, Seth Logen or James Franco, you know? You know, like just explore that for a second. And instead of, like, and this is what I would, like, you know, add to that. Everyone who has a problem with this film, instead of getting defensive to the point of offensive, of accusing every single critic, accusing everyone of being sexist for not looking forward to this film, step back, listen to what they're saying, and say, well, yeah, some people are. There is some sexism involved in this with some people. Let's distance ourselves from those people and say, that's not us. That's not our problem with the film. And that's it. Don't get defensive because they're not talking about you. So there you go. Thoughts?
Well, I don't disagree with you. Again, I have to see the whole video to really get my opinion on the video. But, you know, at this point, I just want the movie to come out already so it can just, the conversation can end. And I'm sure there'll be some other sacred cow work that might be remade or touched. And then everybody.
It's not like they're remaking Citizen Kane or 2001 A Space Odyssey or, you know, hell. I mean, I mean, it's like I was sort of like mocking people that are fans of Goonies.
Yep,
and I know they're out there. I know they're out there, but personally, I think the movie is annoying. I was never a Goonies fan.
Well, you're entitled to your opinion.
No, exactly. And that's the whole point. We're entitled to our opinion. You know? But keep that in mind. We're entitled to our opinion. We don't have to, like, get like position an opinion as that, oh, this is the be-all and end-all, everyone agrees with me, you know, kind of thing. And this justifies why I'm going to hate a movie that hasn't even come out yet and I know nothing about except for what I've seen in a trailer.
You know, like I said, everybody has their own taste. You know, you have a right to your opinion. I'm not going to disagree or agree with you, but I'm probably more going to want to talk to someone who I might see a lot more patterns of agreeing with on films.
Yeah.
Whereas if you're like, oh, I love all these, like, movies I don't necessarily like, we're not going to see common ground half the time when it comes to movies, but I'm still open to talking to you.
Yeah, and we're talking about films that are yet to come out, where we have issues. You know, I can have an issue with how they're approaching. You know, for me, I think like it's fair game if, say, a film is coming out that's going to be directed by someone that has a track record of constantly disappointing me.
Mm-hmm.
Cast with people, hired writers that have a track record and a pattern of making the same, what I perceive to be mistakes over and over and over again. And that's where I'm like, okay, because the production aspect of it, you know, it's like, look, it's not like Brett Ratner's making this Ghostbusters film. Right? You know, it's Paul Feig. And I'm not like the biggest Paul Feig fan in the world, but it's not like he's a hack.
Yeah.
You know, he's done some really interesting stuff. You know, so it's, and the cast is fine, you know. So we'll just see how it goes, you know, whatever. Ghostbusters. I guess, you know, we're at an hour and a half. There's one more thing I guess I could bring up. This is kind of inside baseball, people. But if you're like a part of the horror fan community, all that stuff, this is kind of big news. Fangoria just lost a veteran employee, person that had been there since the 90s, Michael Gingold. Jeff, did you ever meet Michael Gingold?
I never did, but I kept hearing all the stories you and Edwin would tell about.
Yeah, he's a friend of former CineFiles, Edwin Samuelson. I met him a couple of times. He seemed like a really nice guy. I didn't get to know him beyond just meeting him. But he had a reputation in the community. I know he's well-liked. He was very well-connected. He had been with Fangoria forever. He was like a young guy when he started Fangoria, because he's not that old now. And he's been with Fangoria since like the 90s, early 90s, I think. But, you know, it's interesting that Fangoria is a print publication as an example of like what's happening with these fan trades, you know.
Mm-hmm.
There used to be a lot of them. Fangoria, Starlog. Then you had like an explosion of them. Film Threat, you know, Rue Morgue. And then something happens called the internet. A lot of these magazines either disappeared or they became digital only, websites only. And then some of these magazines that still survive went through new acts in their life. In the case of Fangoria, it came under new ownership of a guy named Tom DeFeo. How you spell his last name? Tom DeFeo, I think?
I believe so.
And apparently there was a lot of turmoil as a result of that. Apparently, I don't know the story behind this. All I can say is apparently somebody was holding back money. Writers weren't getting paid. There's a lot of anger directed internally at the publisher. I think there was issues there with the fact that he brought on a gentleman named Chris Alexander, who used to write for Rue Morgue, or one of the Canadian. There's Rue Morgue, and what's the other publication that was out of Canada? I think it was Rue Morgue.
Yeah, the Rue Morgue, yeah.
And hired him to be the new editor-in-chief when he had laid off the original editor-in-chief, the beloved Tommy Timpone, I think it's, or Tommy Timpone, I apologize for pronouncing his last name. There's a lot of tension there because Michael Gingold was passed over for that role when it should have been his. However, it is somewhat commonly recognized that Chris Alexander did turn the magazine around, so it made it popular again. Although there's some controversy there, by doing that, he kind of made himself front and center of that magazine. Some people might consider narcissistic ways, where he made it all about him and how he's the reason why this is successful and all that stuff. But he did turn it around, and then something happened where he left. Totally took everyone by surprise. He's now editor-in-chief of Shock to Drop. Okay. Finally, Mike Engel is given the managing, the editor-in-chief role. And then almost 6 months later, he's gone. Last week, he's gone. And it's not clear whether he's been fired, let go, or he quit. It's not been clear at all what actually happened there. But what does this mean? Whether or not you're interested in the gossips or politics or whatever that was happening behind the scenes at this magazine, the point is maybe this is a death knell, not just for that magazine, but for print in general. It's really, really hard to get a successful print publication continually running, make enough money to pay all your employees, contributors, and all that stuff. It's really, really hard when everyone's going to the internet to read this stuff for free.
Well, I knew something was going on with Fangoria, because it was like they had an issue that came out, I believe it came out almost like 6 months ago, and they hadn't had a new issue since. And not only recently did they put out a new issue, and usually they're, you know, they get articles or doing stories on movie before their time, but for a publication that used to be in advance, it just came out and their main story is on Green Room, which had already been out by the time the magazine.
I know there was an issue with their magazine distributor shutting down, and they lost that distribution, that one option. But they did announce that they would start releasing this stuff quarterly, I think, or something like that, and then they'll. Yeah. But they did try, like, under Chris Alexander's watch, they reintroduced the Gore Zone.
Okay.
Label, which had been dead or dormant for quite a while. He reintroduced that. They're shutting that down. They're not going to make that anymore.
Okay.
So, I mean, who knows? I do know this guy, Tom DeFeo. Again, I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right. I do know that he has a reputation for being a bit of a snake and a sleazeball and a bit of a crook. He's been in court a lot.
Okay.
He's been sued a lot. So it may just happen. It may have. You could chalk it up to just bad management. But the sad thing is, it'd be sad to see this happen to someone like Fangoria. When I was a little kid, I subscribed to Fangoria, you know, and Starlog. And it was something I think I grew out of as I got older.
Okay.
But when I, you know, back in the 90s, when I worked in a bookstore, you know, whenever it would, like, show up on the rack, I would read at my lunch breaks, you know.
Well, that was, as I got older, I actually got into fan horror. I guess as I got into horror movie fandom and then really got into my horror phase, that was my go-to. I mean, I still read Rumorg also, so, you know, but it's going to be sad losing that, just like, again, losing Premiere magazine, Film Threat magazine. And then there was like something like they used to have a magazine called Geek that came out, then all of a sudden disappeared, then it started coming out again, and then it folded again after only two issues.
Remember how popular Wizard was?
Oh yes, I used to get that from the beginning.
Yeah.
And then after I got out of comic books, I was a little shocked that they were still making them, and then of course as soon as I noticed that, that's when they went out of business, because my thing was, I used to read Wizard when it was on its death knell to know what comics to read, since I wasn't into comics as much. So, you know, they would always describe what was happening, what was coming out. So that was my way of keeping up with storylines. Now, I mean, you can go online and do it now, but it was nice to have that little issue, compact, something to read, and, you know, being immersed in your fandom.
Yeah. No, I completely agree. Yeah, and so it's sad. I mean, they did do an announcement after Gingold's dismissal There's the guy that was Mike Ingalls' managing editor is now the new editor-in-chief, and he's made an announcement that, no, we're still going to do this. We're just changing our business model a little bit, and the structure of, like our subscription model. We're going to make up for it, blah, blah, blah. We're hiring two new writers as we speak. But it seems like it's a lot of spin, you know, because you got to understand, a lot of people have heard of Fangoria Magazine, but no one's, you know, been a part of that fan community where, you know, the horror fan community not only know their horror films, they know the writers who write about horror films, right? And Engel was one of those guys. You know, everyone was familiar with his byline whenever they pick up Fangoria Magazine. He's the end, literally the end of an era. Now he's not there anymore. So whatever represented the old guard of Fangoria is gone. Even a guy, I don't know the gentleman's name, but the gentleman that used to illustrate, do all the cover illustrations. He also did some of the cover illustrations for Famous Monsters of Filmland, right? Mm-hmm. They got rid of him, too. So that's it. So I suspect that they're going to meet their promises, stick to their promises, and make sure that those people who did pay for a subscription will get their print versions. But Fangoria will go totally digital from this point on if they insist on continuing, which is what's happened to everything else because it's cheaper. And you don't have to pay your contributors that much, if that anything at all.
So, it's a shame.
It's a shame. So, on that dark note...
Exactly. I was like, way to end the podcast!
On that dark note... Well, the light side of this, someone like Michael Gingold is so well-connected and has so many friends, he's going to land on his feet. He'll probably be fine.
Yeah.
I just hope that he has a better situation than what he had with Fangoria, because that sounded like a mess. But who knows? Anyway, so I think that's it. We've actually talked about a lot, dude.
Yeah, we covered a lot of ground.
We didn't have that annoying Andre Joseph interrupting us every single time and going on and on about the 80s. We missed Andre. We were hoping he could try to join in at some point. He had an engagement, and he thought maybe he could come back in time, but it looks like he can't. So, but you'll be hearing him next time. And who knows, maybe we can get Mike Foltz to come back on in a near future, we'll see.
No blast from the past.
He's just so caught up in family life and working right now. It's really hard for him to commit to doing this with us at the moment. It doesn't mean he won't do it in the future. But until then, this has been the CineFiles. Jeff, say goodbye to the peeps.
Dynamite!
Dynamite. And I'm Eric Holmes. Oh, Jeff.
Yes.
Besides the blog, do you have anything else going on?
I have a Tumblr page that isn't so much devoted to movie writing, but just free writing, where I write sometimes about music and television. You could check jeffthegentleman.tumblr.com or is it jeffthegentleman.com? I don't know how those Tumblr sites work.
Right. And the CineFiles blog is cinefilestv.blogspot.com.
Yes.
Follow us on Facebook. We have a Facebook page and a Facebook group.
Go ahead. No, I was going to say you could also follow Unfinished Business Television on Facebook, where I try to stay up to date on whatever I'm watching in a mini review, like one paragraph mini review.
Right. And he's holding a torch there for that CineFiles blog. Maybe I'll contribute something to it.
Please do.
In a while, yeah. Maybe I will. I've got some thoughts. Since our parent, This Is Infamous, as a website, is no longer. It only exists as a media channel on YouTube now. So there aren't going to be any more written articles for This Is Infamous. All the content will be viewable or listened to, like this podcast. So go to the YouTube channel, subscribe to the This Is Infamous YouTube channel, and you'll get updates on the next CineFiles thing. With regard to that. And if you want to read any of our musings, not that you would, but if you want to, cinefilestv.blogspot.com. Check us out on Twitter. We all have Twitter accounts. You have a Cinefiles Twitter account. Check us out on Facebook. And that's basically it.
Yes, I think we've plugged everything.
I think we've done it. All right, dude. Have a good Memorial Day weekend.
You too.
All right. Goodbye, people.
The CineFiles podcast is a part of This Is Infamous Radio and This Is Infamous Media, executive produced by Billy Donnelly and Eric Cohen.